So good afternoon, dear colleagues. I'm pleased to open the last session for the workshop, the SMARTY workshop, which we have on this Tuesday. And so I'm pleased to invite Irina Peshkova to deliver her talk related to regenerative approaches in multi-server system simulation. So Irina, the floor is yours. Please, welcome.
Regenerative verbs and accelerated simulation of And after time t zero, they switch phase of z from 1 to 0. So we have a so-called exponential switch. So we say that that the case artificial automation approach if at some level t prime discrete component is fixed and is equal to x star, and all continuous components is in exponential stage. So the second approach of artificial generation is to construct instead of the original system system with the same input, but service time, sampling from either F0 or F1 distribution, so instead of the original distribution of T, we will consider its representation. And we use the following coupling result. And we say that beta is regenerate point if we have a fixed number of customers in the system, and all service times are the exponential stage at the time beta n plus 1. This is an example of multiserver model with single state. As discrete component, we consider server model. It's 1 if server is active and 0 if it's in sleeping. So after service completion, the push Q is empty, idle 0 goes to interrupted 0. Yes. And so we have two models. And this is continuous component. T0 is time to the next arrival watch, and Ti and then the time of current activity or service for sleep or sleep. And here you can see how we return the regeneration point. We fix state of serial when all servers are busy and car customers are waiting in the queue. And all continuous components are in exponential stage. About the next possibility to use regeneration of multi-serial simulation is construction of regenerative envelopes. The main idea is the next. For a given original system, sigma, we construct two new systems, Majorant system and Minaret system, with same input. And we fix the number of. And now we consider how to construct the Majorant system. We fix the number of customers in the system, and we say that some case generated point if such process is classically generated. And so we can construct classical generated points. In the same way, we can construct a neural system, and here all linear search times really change by more than a. Now we use coupling property, and because of the input, the same in all systems, and the search times are stochastically ordered. So by coupling property, we have a full equation for the stochastically ordered number of the customers in the system and the queue size. And so it allows to use the heuristic simulation of neural and Magellan system to obtain upper and lower bounds, for example, the queue size. So we construct confidence interval in neural and Magellan system, and we obtain the whole equation for this accuracy. But now, some new ideas about how we can use the property of distribution mu better than used or mu worse than used than used distributions for accelerating of simulations of multiserver systems. About what is mean better used. The distribution F of one variable T has increasing value rate if the following quality holds. F is the distribution in reliability theory, it's a lifetime, remaining a lifetime distribution. So if the full equation holds, and Ft is increasing in T, then we say that distribution F has increasing value. If it decreasing, then we say that F is decreasing power rate distribution. Well, it's easy to see that if it goes to zero, then we have the following quality, and this is called power rate. And it's easy to obtain. For example, variable in gamma distributions with alpha is more than one, increasing power rate distribution, and with alpha less than one, decreasing power rate distribution. And this is a really interesting thing, that for increasing power rate, we have the following equation for the variable. Yes. It means that distribution F is called mu beta that we used if regression holds. And it's, this is equivalent form of this inequality. And here you can see the
maybe vice versa.
So how you can use this property of new value used or new used distribution? For example, if S search time and ST search mean search time at T and S is new was unused distribution. We have the following inequality. So we can, for example, choose some level A, and every time the remaining time is more than A, the sample is from distribution. And we have beta, yes, new service time is beta than now. That's the idea of accelerated simulation in this case. That's all, thank you for attention.
Yeah, thank you so much. So maybe I will be the first who asks the question. So in this case, better means that this is shorter, yeah, because this...
This is short, yes. So we have some level, yes,
So we can guarantee that the new one...
Yes, and the probability that remaining time is bigger than this level is bigger than the original service time. So we can...
Then stochastically it's the way around, yeah?
So it's better to resample service time than to use the limit time.
But it might be also used in some disciplines of, at least I know some sort of disciplines where you, if you have a very long running task, let's say stacked, then you have to, you know, start it from scratch, then it, on average it will be shorter to complete.
For example, in for gamma distribution with parameter I is less than one, for wave distribution, yes, it's heavy wave distribution.
Okay, any more questions, please? Questions? Comments?
Very good.
Let's thank the speaker again. And we move on to the next speaker. I'm very pleased to introduce Julia Dorofeeva. So please welcome. So the talk is named The Problem of Determining a Rating Level in the Education Team. Yeah, please, welcome.
At this moment, the question of the influence of independent centers of influence on the members of the group has been studied. In my report, I propose several conclusions for a group that has members with different rating levels. Next, please. the report is structured as follows. Problem statement, limiting inference of numbers, analysis of the limiting inference vector for the case of one principal and two types of in numbers, numerical example, analysis of limiting inference vector for the case of one principal and three types of team members, and analysis of the limiting inference vector for the case of two principal and principals and two types of ten team members. Problem statement. We consider a group of numbers, each with their own opinions. The opinion of the members at the time can be expressed by a random variable. We obtain a square stochastic matrix of determination n. The sum of rows is about 1. And so we have the dynamics of opinion and dynamics in matrix 4. Thank you. if there is limit, we will talk that we have a consensus. consider the model proposed by Vladimir Buren for a team with two principals and two members who have same rating. In this case, principal don't influence each other, but only themselves. All members of the team have an impact only on their principals and on themselves too. There is no influence on each other. As a result of the solution, we obtain the vector of influence presented on this. Consider a team consisting of two types of members and one principal. The matrix is set similar. The matrix is set similar. In the process of solving, we have the vector of limiting inference. Next slide. Consider a component. We can see the principal's influence on team members. The rating of members of the first subgroup is higher than rating of second. And I made a mistake because as zero decreases, as zero increase.
So it's vice versa. Okay.
Conversely.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. In team has players with higher rating, then the influence of the principal decreases and increase.
Yeah.
Thank you. Next. Ten and 11 slides. I show numerical example. In the first group, we have 15 students and one principal who was a university teacher. In this group, we have 10 students who have a high rating. As good average score, and five students are low. The teacher influence is counted. In the second group, we have 16 students. Five of them have a high rating, and 11 have a low rating. In this case, influence of teacher I solved, and next please. And
maybe you can compare with this.
This case members of high rating and next low rating. This case team with three types of members and one principal. Matrix was found same. Next. And limited influence of numbers. The vector of limited influence also derived for the case when there is one principal and three types of collective members and in the team. And next. And a hard case when we have two types of members and two principals. Next slide, limiting of influence of numbers. Thank you for your attention. Also present a list of used literature. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So it looks that there is some similarity between this model and some sort of, it looks like you are finding a stationary distribution of a Markov chain, in fact. Yeah. So that changing the opinion is some sort of jumps in between the chain, Markov chain evolving. Yeah.
I like
the
example of Rumyantsev. I studied postgraduate the first year.
Okay, so this is just the beginning of the problem statement.
I'm
beginning
with my research advisor.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so let's thank the speaker. Well, let's test. Okay, please.
It is a new area for me, and can you say, for example, who is the principal in student group, for example?
Teacher.
The
Okay, so let's thank the speaker again. So we move on to the third speaker. Yes, and I am pleased to welcome Oleg Lukashenko to deliver his talk for this game theory session. Although it might not be very relevant to game theory, but we've made an interchange in between by some scheduling reasons. So this is much maybe more related to the stochastic modeling track, but we see that these tracks are more or less interconnected, so we can find interpretations in both areas. So please, Oleg, the floor is yours.
Good afternoon, dear colleagues. Usually, I start with thanking to be an opportunity to have a talk here. So, Alex, thank you very much. And I apologize for not providing the title of the talk in advance. So, actually, in advance, right here, I decided to repeat my talk presented in the conference on variance simulation at the end of August. So it's a joint talk with my colleagues, Yussi Manozakis and Alexander Vadina, who actually is present here now. So the title of my talk is Application of the Variance Reduction Technique to Estimation Degradation Systems. Next slide, please. The outline of my talk can be summarized as follows. I start from the model description, then I go to my performance measures in the evaluation process, and the main performance measure I'm very interested in is actually so-called failure probability. And we can see that it's probability in context of rare event simulation. Then I describe conditional Monte Carlo method estimation such probability, then present some numerical results in order to illustrate the performance of the proposed estimation, and then in bright describe some notes on analytic study of the performance of the proposed estimation. So we follow which proposed paper by Vasim and Pafradov. They introduced this terminology. So actually we can see the stochastic process X, which is called degradation process. It's actually a stochastic process with a finite state space E, and actually only four states play special role, namely state A, M, K, and P. I think it's possible to skip this description, and I think it's better to explain this on the following picture, please, on the next slide. So, in this picture is presented the typical sample path of a considered process. So actually, the process starts from zero, and after that, visit step by step each intermediate stage. After reaching the state capital M, there are two possibilities. One of them, the process reach the state K. After that, the so-called state of preventive repair, then it just jump back to the stage of return M, visit this stage during some random time SLM, and then moves up. The second possibility is that instantaneous failure occurs after some random variable capital B, which is actually a random variable with given distribution. Then, if the failure occurs, the process jumps to initial state L, some repairment period actually involved during some also random time S, and then it continues from the state 0. So the typical path is actually is vice constant and trajectory, right? So to denote the transition time from state E to the next state as capital G I, and to convenience denote as A G, overall time spent between states texture that this process has generated structure, the moments of the regeneration is actually the moments when the process hits stage M, they collided and by green color here. So in order to obtain to calculate inlet has some characteristics, it's possible to use regenerative simulation, which was applied by my colleagues. And the next stage is actually we are interested by two types of regenerative cycles. The first one is a cycle with failure and without failure. So this failure is highlighted by red color and without failure is highlighted by blue color. So, we are interested in estimation of the following performance measure. So first is the length of the cycle without failure and this failure, so called unconditionally generated cycle, like the probability, the failure probability PF, and this during this talk actually concentrated on estimating this probability actually. It is important to know that we are interested to estimate this probability in case when it will be extremely small, because in this case when this probability is small, the reliability function can be approximated by the following expression, despite general results from the reliability theory. We are interested to consider the case that this probability is close to zero. Extremely close to zero. The next case. So, just a definition of probability. To find in analytically generally is impossible because it involves multiple convolution operations because there is a sum of independent random variables. The random variable capital means assumed to be independent of the distribution of stage capital G. So, the next slide please. Closed form expression is known in a particular case where random variables capital G are identical exponential random variables. Of course, it's possible to use Laplace transform, but in order to use it, we need to inverse Laplace transform, which actually usually is obstructible. So the reason, another approach is to use Monte Carlo methods in order to calculate this probability, but the problem is that the main Monte Carlo method usually fails when we want to estimate small probabilities. So some variance reduction techniques should be applied if it's possible. And we applied so-called conditional Monte Carlo method, which a special variant of conditional Monte Carlo method, which was firstly proposed by Asmussen in 2006. conditional Monte Carlo name is such a because it involves conditional expectation, actually. Also referred to this rather qualitative approach sometimes in some papers and books. So the next slide, please. Oh, let's suppose that random variable capital B belongs to some parameter set of distribution, depends on some parameter theta. Parameter theta is so-called relative parameter, it means that when theta tends to infinity, the probability of interest tends to zero. So the node is capital beta, the estimator of probability, a typical measure of the goodness of the estimator is expressed by so-called relative error, which defined in the following way is actually a variation coefficient. So the problem that for many Monte Carlo is relative error tends to infinity, it's unbounded. So this is why we use some advanced techniques. The proposed estimator is probability can be written in the following form, in the following way. It's actually was proposed by Asmussen and Kruse, and the main difference is that that in our thinking actually V is a random variable. So they proposed this method to estimating the table distribution for the sum independent random variable. In this case it's constant. SNK is sum of independent random variables, and we assume the distribution of random variable T is heavy tailed. More precisely, we consider sort of exponential trees because it includes the most popular examples of heavy-tail distribution, like Weigel distribution, Weigel-Riemann distribution, log normal, and some others. So, when the random variable V is concentrated in one point, so it's a constant. So this problem is actually the tail distribution of the random variable S, and it was slightly studied problem. So I have already mentioned the article of Asmussen and Kruse. In this article, they showed that this estimator has bounded relative error. It is proved for Weigel and Pareto distribution under some conditions on the parameters. So, for example, for Weigel distribution with a k parameter beta, the condition is following. So, for the shape parameter beta less than some threshold beta star, it has bounded relative error. 3 years later, Hartwig and Kurchak even prove that for beta less than another threshold level, two stars, that it is even have vanishing relative error. So the relative error even tends to zero is quite a strong property. And the main question actually for us, under which conditions on distribution of random variable capital V, the Asmussen-Kruse estimator keeps such properties? Then I start presenting some numerical results for Pareto stage T and then for Weigel stage T. So these results for Pareto stage T. So we estimate the following probabilities, assuming to benchmark undocumented carbon. Also, we estimate the relative error. So, it's good to know that it will indeed decrease to zero condition and the carbon.
So sorry, but still the relative error has two orders more than the estimate itself.
Right? Yeah, but I think it's not principal.
Okay.
Because it's also relative error, we can also estimate it, so it's also random error, actually. The next slide, please. So the same for the variable stage. And we presented good results, the bad results also present here. In order to present bad results, we consider another type of uniform distribution. When then the variance of capital V actually depends on the relative parameter. So in this example, it doesn't depend on the relative parameter feedback. In this example, it depends on the relative parameter. So on the first case, relative error according to the numerical results indeed tends to zero. The second example is increase. Probability questions, how fast it increases. The next slide, please. After introducing some numerical results, let's try to prove these properties by analytic methods. For simplicity, we can see the particular case that random variable capital V is actually sum of some constant and random variable psi, where the distribution of random variable psi actually doesn't depend on the relative parameter feature. Following approach proposed by Hartinger and Kotchak, let's consider the case that the estimator capital Z exhibits the following properties. So there exists some deterministic function A such that the following ratio converges to some constant with probability 1. I'm not sure it converges. Then, actually, a simple exercise. A simple student exercise, I think. If we consider the square, simplicity, the square of the relative error, conditions are are the rich, the fully interchanging expectation is true, is a much more challenging problem actually. The next slide, please. So, the problem reduces some standard analysis issue to prove that following interchanges lead to standard condition for this so-called Validesky dominated time purchase theorem, which is a probabilistic interpretation is a problem. Just to find a random variable U is a finite second moment such that the closest inequality holds. If we find such random variable, we can interchange limit and expectation actually. So actually it's the main step in the proof and condition 3 is established separately for different subclasses of sub-exponential distribution. So we can see the step by step variable distribution, regular variant, log normal, pushing by flowchart, and dividing the action. In some cases, it's indeed the next slide. As a further improvement, one can think about so-called control variate methods. So, a comparable version is actually the following estimator, which is actually some kind of weighted sum of estimated Z, and involves some actually random variable Y is given with some given distributions, and in order to minimize the variance of the proposed estimate, it's quite straightforward to show that this constant C can be chosen in the following way. So, in case, in bad case, then the variance of the random variable depends on the relative parameter. Such improved estimate usually significantly outperforms the less improved previous estimator in terms of the relative error. Next slide, please. So I won't conclude my talk. We can see there's a problem applying variance reduction technique to consider the problem, and there are some possible future research directions. I hope this is our going work. So one of the possible future directions is starting to more detail the conditions when the estimator considers multi-asymptotic properties, extensions on so-called heterogeneous case, when the distribution of stages depends on limits I, and development variance reduction and speed-up techniques to estimate other important characteristics of the considered degradation process. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Any questions, please? So no questions? Okay, then at least I have to ask one. So it seems that in this case always you have these regeneration points, yeah?
Yeah.
But they are too rare to be used in practice, or you also can use this some sort of regenerative simulation to address this quantity.
Actually, for the failure probability estimation, regeneration doesn't really matter because the regenerative approach was obtained for calculating another characteristics.
but of course you can estimate the mean indicator, which is in fact the probability that you are trying to. Okay. So that could be a point for comparison of these techniques, yeah.
Yeah.
To combine forces. Yeah. Okay. So thank you once again. And we move on to the concluding part. So I have one talk that I plan to share with you, and then I announce some concluding remarks probably. So I'm not sure how to do that, because maybe then Oleg can be the slide switcher. Right in this.
Okay, then.
I think I will try to show them at all, because actually. So I will try to address this as a kind of trying to exploit some technical feature that we managed to find out in the model, but seems that the model is not new, but during the proof, this feature was not used. So by this reason, once we noticed that, we tried to extend the model to preserve this specific feature, and then you will see what happens. So please, next step. So to get some inspiration for applications, we are talking about the retrial queues. And the retrial queues are relevant mostly in the context of the telecommunication systems, let's say call centers or short TCP transfers or whatever. But even we managed to find some applications in the more close to our group applications, like the Boeing desktop grids and the high performance computing systems and whatever. So, but it is the nice point about the maths, yeah? So you can use the same model for modeling different things, and then the results stay the same practically. I mean, the interpretation may differ, but the results are the same. So we are focusing on this constant retrial system, and also maybe it's better to call it orbit queue, because the customers who are staying at a specific place and trying to approach the server, but not necessarily when the server becomes idle, it can grab a customer, but there is some idle time before a customer tries to approach the server. And this type of retrial queues may be considered as some sort of orbit queue. So there is an orbit, a specific place where the customers are waiting and trying to once again to approach the server. But in this case, we may think of it like we are standing in the queue and only the first one is testing. So the first customer is trying to approach the server, and once the server is free, then the customer starts its independent service time. So the other ones are moving forward in the order queue and trying to do the same. Once again, to test if there is something there. Maybe you may think of it like multiple access protocols in wireless networks, where they are trying to listen for the first, to listen if the channel is empty, and then transmit something. But if the channel is busy, then they just try once again. So also there is the two-way communication. That means, in fact, that once the server becomes empty, it can wait for some time and then try to do the outgoing call. It's interesting to consider this in the context of the call center. So let's say the operator is answering the calls, he or she is answering the calls, and then once, let's say, some minutes, there is no incoming call, then the operator may decide to do the outgoing call, let's say to advertise some products of a bank or whatever, so I don't know, but for some reason, or maybe you can think of it as some sort of vacation, that the server becomes unavailable for some specific period of time. Also, you may think of it as a kind of internal routine that is performed by the server. So the server starts some maintenance operation. The key feature is that during this time, the server is unavailable for all the calls, for both the coming from the orbit and
coming from outside. So this may be considered a call. So there is some literature, but I will not focus on it. So the key feature is that mostly, in some cases, even the stability criterion is difficult to approach. So, and the methods for the analysis are very various, but in some cases these are matrix-analytic methods or regenerative approaches or some other methods of univariate analysis. But still, there are quite some things to do. So this is the model to start with. So it was already studied. And I will try to move from this model to explain the idea and then to extend it to a new case. So let's say this is a single server queuing system. There is a Poisson and Arrow input. There are general service time distributions, and there is no waiting space at server. And there is a single orbit. That means when a customer comes and the server is busy, the customer goes to the orbit and starts trying to approach the server. But maybe we can think of it as a queue, and then that only the first one is trying to approach with some rate. So the trial rate is lambda r, and during the idle times, the server can initiate the outgoing call with, after the exponentially distributed waiting time, which he spends waiting for any customer to come, but if he doesn't come, then he starts outgoing call. And the outgoing call is also exponential duration with rate mu. And we denote some quantities, so this is kind of the rate of the incoming calls, primary incoming calls, let's say. These are the calls that come from orbit, and these are the internal routings or the outgoing calls. So, like this notation. So we are interested in some stationary performance measures. Of course, they are very easy in that sense that they give only very general information about the system. Let's say this is the probability that the server is idle. This is the probability that the system is empty. These are empty orbit or busy orbit probabilities. This is the idle server at the same time the orbit is busy, and vice versa, and also busy server and busy orbit. So this is kind of very general knowledge, but still in some cases, let's say this knowledge is very important, that if this quantity is positive, that the system is stable. So for this reason, at least it can give us some information. These probabilities can give us some information about the system performance, and moreover, from this set of relations, you can see that, let's say, for instance, if you define these and these quantities, then practically everything is defined, because from this relation you can find this one, also you can define this one, and from this you can find this one, finally arrive to this, and then you define this. So once you have, let's say, three of them, you can solve everything. Not necessarily all three, but that's it. But at least two in a row, I can afford them. So, but in some cases, it is difficult to approach at this point. So these are the results from a very recent paper published after the QTNA conference. And this is the case when not all the quantities of our interest could be found. So, for instance, probability that the server is busy and the orbit is empty is not a test in this particular case, because it's a very tough technique to approach this quantity. But in this case, let's say, in this case, it's a more simple model without the outgoing calls, but still all the quantities of interest can be found. So the stability condition, I will not focus on it, but just to mention that once we have this probability of an empty system and we see that the probability is positive, in fact, you arrive to the stability conditions. So this is the case of our model of interest, but with outgoing calls, and in case the service time is exponential. So by this reason, we can use the matrix-analytic method to arrive at all these quantities. And I will show how. So usually when we use the matrix-analytic method, we try to describe the system as some kind of structured Markov chain. In this case, the structure means that there are two components. One of them is usually called level, and the second one is phase. And the idea is that the level is decreased or increased only by one. That is, that gives the name of a quasi-birth-death process, because the birth is increasing and the death is decreasing in this case. But quasi means that the second component may also change in some very complicated way, maybe. So it means that at the transition epoch, the chain in continuous time experiences such a transition in such a way that the first component is only changed plus minus one, or maybe stays the same, but the second component may change in some arbitrary way. That means that the generator matrix has the following three diagonal block structure. So you can see here all of these are matrices. In some case, so in this particular case, these are square matrices, but maybe these three may be of different dimension in general case. So, but also you have this repeating structure there. That means that this case is called the so-called level-independent process. That means that after some specific level, there is kind of a repetitive structure. So these are the explicit expressions about these matrices, and usually once you have these expressions, you can arrive at the, after some, maybe, in general case, after some numerics, you arrive at the solution of the system. But I want to point one thing that here, you can see the matrix that is of rank one. That means that here you have only one specific value in fact. And these rows are zero. This is a very nice feature, but which was not, to the best of my knowledge, which was not pointed out for this model. So maybe in this case we can arrive at the explicit expressions. Please proceed. And so the idea is how to get this R, because all this probability of stationary states, yes, or the stationary probabilities of this continuous time Markov chain are delivered in such a way that we get this nice matrix geometric solution. The only question is how to find R, and R is found as a matrix that solves this matrix equation, but usually it's done numerically. And P0 is found by this system, which is also done in a numerical way. But in this case, we may obtain it explicitly. So this is the well-known result by Latouche and Ramaswamy. At least there you can find it in their monograph. You can find this result. So this is the expression for R matrix, and G matrix is expressed by this row. So this is the kind of exposition of this matrix of rank one. In our case, this is explicitly defined like this in this way. So you can easily check that multiplying this column vector by this row vector, you can arrive at our matrix P2. And this means that we can find R explicitly. After some computations, you have to do this inversion, but of course this is very simple for this case. You can arrive at this matrix and find P0, the probability of initial, let's say, state, or boundary state, as follows, where P00 is defined like in this way. And also from P00, of course, you can get this stationary regimes, also the stability condition. Next one, please. And now we are trying to keep this specific feature, to keep the feature that A2 is a rank 1 matrix. So to generalize the model in such a way that A2 is still rank 1 matrix. So we are looking at this two-way communication system, but with multiple customer classes. So previously we had only one customer class. That means that the same customers of the same type are in the system, they have a single object, etc. But in this case, we are trying to generalize. So we have multiple customer classes of incoming calls, and also we have multiple classes of outgoing calls. This is terrible. But the customer chooses its class only after approaching the server. What does it mean? So when a customer comes, there is a specific stream of customers, and the customer arriving at an empty server, he is the customer with class I with such probability because this is a possible stream. And the service time distribution depends, is exponential and depends on the service range which is related to the customer class. But if the server is busy, then the customer will try to join an orbit and forgets about his decision. So that is maybe a restrictive point of view. So once being in the orbit, let's say each time the customer selects its class independently once again, or whatever, or maybe he forgets about his decision or forgets about his class, and then later on after calling back to the server, he selects some other class. So the retrial rates are also related to customer classes, but in this case the probability that the customer is of class I is this one, which is independent on the previous choice. So in the orbit, the customers do not keep their previous choice when they were trying to approach the system at the first time. And of course, when the server is idle, he's trying to make one of the outgoing calls from one of these L classes. So the probability of choosing some specific classes like follows. And service rate, of course, is related to this outgoing call class. We make some notations here, but they are very straightforward. Just they only depend on the class of incoming call and outgoing call. And we make these simplifications just to simplify things. So please. The matrix is a bit more nasty, but still, it resembles me the matrix that Julia had in studies, so maybe we can think of some interpretation of these matrices in your model, for instance. But so to point out, this matrix is still a matrix of rank 1. That means that we have only one row in 0. And that means that we can do this all these nice explicit solutions. We can find the stability criterion, which is has very nice interpretation, like the stability of an orbit, because this is kind of a rate that goes to orbit. During the busy time of the server, the input stream goes to orbit, and this is during the idle time of the server, the retrial rate decreases to orbit. So this is kind of negative drift condition, of course. And the nice point behind that is the dependence on lambda is quadratic, so we can find the specific stability region for lambda, which is less than from the star. The left part is below zero. So this is, of course, we can do this explicit solution by obtaining this matrix R and obtain P0 to find stationary joint probability. But in this case, maybe doing this is a little bit tricky and requires some complicated computations, and by this reason we are trying to do it in some different way. This next one. Okay, so we can skip the discussion. So this is the thing that I want to point out at the end of my talk. So obtaining P0 is itself tricky, because after obtaining R explicitly, we already have done one inversion of the matrix, and then usually the expressions are quite complicated. And to do one more inversion, it's not very easy, and I mean, if you want to arrive at some nice formulas. So by this reason, we are trying to introduce the following quantity, which is related to original P0 by the following expressions.
That means that our original system can be rewritten as follows. So in fact, this is something that connects. So I may be wrong now, but because during the talk I'm just trying to address this intuitively, but so it is something that connects. P0 is related to the probability of zero state of an orbit, and Z0 is related to probability of zero state of the server. And this is their interconnection. So by this reason, we can find these by regenerative approach, by using the regenerative approach. So this is something that combines the previous literature that I mentioned during my talk. So this was found in the paper by Duan and in QDNA. This is the expressions for this model with additional restriction just to simplify the writing. And the matrix analytic stuff is in the other paper. So we are trying to combine these approaches. So for instance, it's easier by using a regenerative approach and these balance approaches, it's easier to obtain these. And then, starting from these, by doing only one multiplication, by this matrix, you do not need any more versions, you can arrive at this P0. And after finding P0, since you have the R matrix, then you define all the stationary probabilities in this iterative nice matrix geometric way. So thus, after that, consistently with the stability criteria we had, this is the P00 for our generalized model in case of this additional restriction. Thank you for attention, and I will be happy to answer your
questions.
Not to estimate. So, to find P0 from the matrix analytic method is kind of a complicated procedure. Because you need to solve the linear quotient, but you do it by doing some more inversions of the matrix that is itself already inverted, so then it implies some complicated, you know, technical stuff. So, in this case, we do not find P0 explicitly, but we find Z0, but we find it from a generated approach. So we are writing this balance equations for the cumulative processes divided by T, let T go to infinity, and then we get to this formula. And after that, we only need to multiply this by I minus R, which is not inverted, because R is inverted, but I mean, so usually you can obtain that. So for instance, here I obtained this explicitly for our general. Thank you for the questions.
What do you mean L?
L is the number of outgoing call classes. Number of classes. So we have different types of outgoing calls.
Unbounded.
The orbit is unbounded. Mm-hmm. Orbit is unbounded. So by this reason, we address this to be
one orbit. Only one orbit.
Yeah, this is the. I call this kind of mixed orbit too, because this is orbit is one, but the customer classes, they are kind of mixed.
Maybe it's interesting if not one, for example, two orbit and three and
We studied this actually. You see, addressed this issue during his invited talk on this conference. So if you have multiple orbits, then you cannot use the matrix analytic method apart from the case when one of the, let's say, orbits is bounded. Mm-hmm. So in this case, the orbit will itself become a kind of phase, whatever. But here, if you have two orbits that are growing independently, in this case, you cannot do this matrix analysis. So by this reason, we have done this mixed orbit.
Because in into a position, since a portion of the to you then, obviously.
Yeah, it's very tricky stuff. Thank you. So, if no more questions, then we have one more.
Questions. Just a remark. So, you mentioned the connection between Julia talk and your talk, but Julia worked in discrete time.
Yeah, of course.
You worked in continuous time and it's the matrix.
Yeah, yeah.
For the indifferent structure, but maybe. Some kind of books about the infiltrate, the human, they're also
So, well, of course, you can do this uniformization from this continuous time to move to discrete time. So it's a kind of point of discussion.
And just another question, also posed by your sentence on some slides. So you mentioned here generated function, generated functions. Here is an alternative approach.
Yeah, right.
What is your experience to much more complicated systems like retrieval systems? Are there some successful attempts to apply a generative function approach?
Yeah, I think of course they are. Maybe since the 80s, I think they are. There are such
some
teaching. Maybe. Of course, they could be, but. So I mean, in this case, we were trying just to use the tool that we have at this kind of, as I already said before. So we are trying to exploit some specific feature of the model and try to enrich the model in such a way to keep this specific feature. So maybe this is kind of a technical trick that we try to do this. But of course, I mean, maybe in many cases you can just avoid these matrices and just use the generated. It is always the point of discussion. What tool to use? What method to start with? I'm pleased to close this workshop. So I hope that all of us at least had some fruitful time here and had some fruitful discussions and many interesting and even social events we had. So thank you once again for joining this, because you know we had some gap in between the schedule, so I hope you can stand for you came to stand for this session, and it was really interesting to listen to the talks. So thank you once again, and I hope that it will be not the last one SMARTY workshop in Korea. Thank you all.